a fantastic crowd. I was here last year the same time, and there was a huge crowd just like this, and they were giving away a $1,000 drawing for a mortgage payment. How many of you were here for that? Remember that? And when I came back this time, I was so afraid there wouldn't be very many people here because I was worried that last time you were only here for the drawing. But now I see that you really do love me. I'm having a Sally Fields moment up here. This is great. Thank you, Pastor Bruce. I love this series. I think this is one of the greatest things that any church in Owasso does. I'm a huge fan of the Live Better series, and I could go on and on bragging about it, but Pastor Bruce did not give me enough time because he says we start on time, we quit on time, so I'm going to jump right into it. Tonight, I hope to challenge your thinking a little bit about the concept of stewardship and how we use the resources entrusted to us in a manner that brings glory and benefit to God, and then also benefits others around us. So the first concept, I want to discuss the biblical concept of stewardship. Most Americans are more concerned with their rights than their responsibilities. A steward has no rights. A steward only has responsibilities. A steward is someone who cares for the property or affairs of another or someone else. Before we were politically correct and had flight attendants, we had stewardesses. And the job of the stewardess was to care for other people and other people's property. And that's exactly what you and I are when it comes to caring for and managing the resources that God entrusts to us. We know that we brought nothing into this world and we can take nothing out of it. Every single thing we have, every good and perfect gift comes from God. And while on this earth, we are merely a steward of those resources and are to use them for His glory and His benefit. For my text tonight, I want to use the parable of the talents because I think it sets up a framework for us to look at this concept of stewardship. So I'm going to be reading the parable of the talents from Matthew 25, starting in verse 14. And as I read this from the NIV, I want you to think about these passages in terms of money management and not focus so much on the spiritual context for just this one purpose. Okay, here we go. Again, it will be like a man going on a journey who called his servants and entrusted his property to them. To one he gave 5 talents of money, to another 2 talents, and to another 1 talent, each according to his ability. Then he went on his journey. The man who had received the 5 talents went at once and put his money to work and gained 5 more. So also the one with the 2 talents gained 2 more. But the man who had received the 1 talent went off, dug a hole in the ground, and hid his master's money. After a long time, the master of those servants returned and settled accounts with them. The man who had received the 5 talents brought the other 5. Master, he said, you entrusted me with 5 talents. See, I have gained 5 more. His master replied, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness. The man with the 2 talents also came. Master, he said, you entrusted me with 2 talents. See, I have gained 2 more. His master replied, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness. Then the man who had received the 1 talent came. Master, he said, I knew that you are a hard man, harvesting where you have not sown and gathering where you have not scattered seed. So I was afraid and went out and hid your talent in the ground. See, here is what belongs to you. His master replied, you wicked, lazy servant. So you knew that I harvest where I have not sown and gather where I have not scattered seed. Well, then, you should have put my money. Okay, here comes my favorite part. Well, then, You should have put my money on deposit with the bankers. Notice it does not say those Ebola-spreading credit unions, Merrill Lynch, Charles Schwab, any of those places. And look, these words are in red. Thus saith the Lord. Put your money on deposit with the bankers so that when I returned, I would have received it back with interest. Take the talent from him and give it to the one who has the 10 talents. For everyone who has will be given more, and he will have an abundance. Whoever does not have, even what he has will be taken from him. And throw that worthless servant outside into the darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. I believe this passage gives us 5 great examples and concepts to consider about stewardship. Number 1, get your pen out, here we go. The slaves were not each equally gifted. The slaves were not each equally gifted. How were they gifted? Each according to their ability. That's why I think series like Live Better and Andy Stanley series and Ramsey's series and any you can go to are of benefit, because as we improve our ability to manage resources, I believe we'll be entrusted with more. The slaves were given funds based on their ability. Number 2, the slaves had no control over the amount entrusted to them. They had no control over the amount entrusted to them. When folks come to visit with me about household budgeting and financial management issues, do you think I get more questions on how I can save money or more questions on how I can make more money? Make more money. Here's the problem. Most of us, just like the slaves, have very little control over our incomes. Just yesterday, Vicki Sharon at Dr. O's office at the school sent our bank a list of all of the school location winners of the Teacher of the Year. And we put them up on our marquees and run them for 2 or 3 months. And come April, they'll have a big celebration and announce the teacher of the whole district. How much money more will the best teacher at Hodson make next year because she's the best teacher at Hodson than she made this year? Zero. Now, I know we can go back to school, we can get more education, we can get a master's degree. Some of us are in a position to work overtime, but for the most part, we have little control over our incomes. What we can focus on is the expense side. We have almost total control over that side, and that's where our energy should be spent. Number 3, I believe this is the most important concept I have learned for me personally in my life. C, all were not expected to produce the same results. All were not expected to produce the same results. Now, I'm going to take a minute to get really personal and real with you. My great-grandfather, his name was Dominic Sokolosky, and he lived in his entire life in Lithuania and Poland. My grandfather's name was Dominic Tony Sokolosky, and he immigrated from Poland to the United States through Ellis Island in the late 19-teens before the outbreak of World War I, and he moved to southeast Oklahoma to Hartshorn to work in a coal mine. My dad's name is Dominic Mitchell Sokolosky. He's the son of a coal miner who was raised in Hartshorn and McAllister and went off to Weatherford to pharmacy school. My dad was raised dirt poor. He did not have transportation to get to college. My dad hitchhiked from McAllister, Oklahoma to Weatherford, Oklahoma to go to college. My parents did not have money to support my father in college, so my dad worked in the rabbit and mice labs, cleaning out the cages and feeding the experimental animals to work his way through college. Essentially, my dad shoveled rat crap to work his way through school. When he and my mom got married in 1956, they bought a little drugstore down at 76th and Main in Owasso, where Kathy Campbell's Medicap Pharmacy is today. When my mom and dad got married and moved to Owasso, they rented a house in the old downtown part of Owasso, and they slept in the floor because they couldn't afford a bed. Here comes along the fourth Dominic Sokolosky. I didn't have to hitchhike from Owasso to Stillwater to go to school because my parents bought me a car. And I didn't have to work my way through business school and law school because my parents paid for every dime of it. And when I graduated from law school, my dad and mom bought me a new car and said, here, you have a car, you have no debt, you have a good income, a good job. In 1983, I was making $36,000 a year, which was a boatload of money in 1983. And so I'm thinking, oh, I left out one piece of the puzzle. My mom and dad sold Sox Drugstore in 1979, and my dad effectively retired at the age of 47. Now, he still did some work overseeing the bank. He was still a real estate developer, but the days of punching in 9 to 5 ended for my dad at the age of 47. So I'm thinking, if my dad can start with absolutely nothing and use his entrepreneurial skills and real estate skills and basically retire at the age of 47, I should easily be able to retire by the time I'm 40. Guess what? I'm 57, 58, I lose track. Whatever I am, I'm still down there at the bank. Now, for years, it would eat me up because I came back to my hometown where a whole bunch of people knew me. And I would always get the question, you know, when are you going to be a developer like your dad? When are you going to do things like Sock? When are you going to do this? And I would just smile and laugh. But inside, I was churning. Because every single time I compared myself to my dad, I came in second or last. And it just ate me up that I would never be the man. And, of course, I was only thinking from the standpoint of making money. I'd never be the man that my dad was. Until one day my pastor conned me into teaching a class at the church on biblical financial principles, and I came along this passage. And one day it hit me. I didn't get the 5 talents. My dad did. It was his job to turn them into 10. I probably got 2 or 3. It's my job to only use the gifts and talents and resources given to me and not compare myself to somebody else. If we spend our time comparing ourselves to somebody else, there's always somebody better looking, thinner, faster, stronger, has more money, happier, whatever than us. That's a futile exercise, and it's especially killing in a family environment to compare yourself to somebody else when it comes to money. Now, my dad is a real estate entrepreneurial genius, but he's never in his lifetime taught a Sunday school class or taught biblical financial principles or done any seminars or spoken at a church or written any materials on financial principles. But I have, because I got the gift of teaching, he got the gift of giving. Powerful. And when you get those bricks off your shoulders, it frees you up to do what God's called you to do, not what he called your dad to do. You're welcome. Can I get a witness? Okay. All right, D. Those who invested wisely were entrusted with more. That's the great news. Those who managed the resources well as given to them were entrusted with more. And E, the last one, here's the bad news. The one who did not invest his resources had his taken away and given to someone who did. Let that never be the case with us. Let us always look for more abilities, more education, be a better manager of the resources entrusted to us. Okay, that's the first takeaway. Here's the second one. I was raised by two parents that are old school in most of the ways we would consider old school or conservative. And one of the things they taught me from a very early age is they support the people who support them. They do business with the people that do business with them. They owned the only pharmacy in town from 1956 to 1979. Can you believe in 1979 there was still only one pharmacy in Owasso? Now there's what, 38? I mean, I don't know, there's a bunch. So I was a little boy. I was probably 9 or 10 years old. I was raised in the drugstore. And I had this little crummy bike that was probably wonderful when Santa Claus gave it to me. But I had kind of outgrown it. And my brothers and sisters and I, back in a much safer, more wonderful day, we used to ride our bikes the 6 miles on 86 to 129th to 76, back to 161st, all the way around that 6 miles because 145th doesn't all go all the way through. And we did that on our bicycles because we picked up pop bottles in the bar ditch. Because back in those days, you could pick up the pop bottles because people just threw them out, and you could take them to Wells Food Market down on 76th and Main, where the pawn shop is now, and turn them in for 2 cents. Well, I needed a bigger, better bike. So I went to my mom, and I said, I've saved some money, and I'd like to buy me a new bicycle. And she said, that's great. You go right down the street here to the Western Auto. And in the mid-1960s, there was a Western Auto just down from where Medicap is, where the bicycle shop is now. And a couple named Wes and Sharon L. Stevens owned the Western Auto. They have since passed away. Their daughter is Sherry McLaughlin that owns Art and Bloom Flower Store. So Mom said, you're going to go down to Western Auto and find the bike that you want, and you buy it from Mrs. Stevens. That was the end of the shopping discussion. There wasn't going to be any, well, let's go to Tulsa and see what Otasco has, and maybe I can get a better bike or a cheaper bike at Otasco. Why did Mom insist that I buy the bike from Mr. and Mrs. Stevens? They bought their prescriptions at Sox Drugstore. And it would be the height of hypocrisy and unneighborliness to go someplace else when we needed something that they sold. Too few of us today think that way. When we built our new bank building, I made it a point to search out every single client that we had at the bank and see if there was any way I could give them the business in the construction of that building. Every single piece of glass in that five-story building was bought from Advantage Glass, which is owned by Barb and Cheryl Reisenhoover, that live in Owasso, bank at First Bank of Owasso, are Christians, and tithe to a local church in Owasso. All of the heating, air conditioning, those underground heat pumps that I know nothing about, all of the plumbing was done by Davco Mechanical, because Virgil and Dwayne came to me to finance the start of their business 15 years ago, and they're Christians, and they live here, and they support a local church. All of the sod was provided by Brown Farm Sod. I went to high school with Alan Brown. Alan Brown banks at First Bank of Owasso. He's a local guy. He supports a local church. As I'm writing what ended up being over $10 million worth of checks, the vast majority of which went to somebody in our community that provided jobs to somebody I probably live close to and supported a local church, I believe that's better for the kingdom than it is for me to find the low bidder. I'm doing our budget now for the next year. I just looked at last year's payroll and last year's profits, and I know all 69 of those people that get a paycheck, and I know all 37 or 8 of the shareholders of the bank. And just off of payroll and profits from that one little bank, the kingdom got over $750,000 in tithes last year. Does it make a difference to the body of Christ if we carefully choose who we provide our resources to? Yeah, I believe it does. Every single Wednesday at all three First Bank of Owasso locations, we have a team meeting, and one of our employees does a client spotlight. And they will highlight between 1 and 4 clients of the bank to make sure every single one of our employees knows who's providing our paycheck. That is really, really important to me. Your church has been spotlighted. One day somebody will do all the flower businesses that sell flowers at bank with us, and somebody will do all the fitness people, and just to keep it out there. Well, about 15 years ago, I was down at the old bank, 76 in Maine, and got an email from one of our employees, and she said Texaco, right down there on 76th Street, was having a price war on gas, and you could buy your gas 5 cents cheaper than you could buy it anywhere in Owasso. Well, I've known Melvin and Patsy Spencer since I was in junior high. And they used to own Spencer's Shortstop on 86th Street. Melvin and Patsy have lived here their whole life. Melvin was my driver's ed instructor in high school. I wasn't good enough to play baseball for Melvin, but I was a world-class driver. Okay. They honored us by allowing us to finance Spencer's Shortstop. And we financed the construction of their home. So every single drop of gasoline that went into a yellow Volkswagen with eyelashes on it was bought at Spencer's Shortstop. And all the gas that went into the executive cars and the trucks that do the inspections, all the gas is bought from Melvin and Patsy. And one of my employees just sent out an email encouraging every person at my bank to vote with their dollars to buy their gas from somebody else. Go down to Texaco. So I walk over to her desk. And I said, A, we don't use company email to pass out shopping tips. And B, are you aware that part of the paycheck you just got Friday was paid for by Melvin and Patsy Spencer? And the profits from them selling gas at Spencer's Shortstop makes our payroll. And you just sent out an email encouraging 60 of us to go buy gas from Texaco. Texaco doesn't bank here. I've never seen Texaco give a dime to the Owasso Public Schools. I've never seen their name at Owasso Community Resources. I've never seen their name at a Miss Owasso pageant. I've never seen their name at the Crisis Pregnancy Center. I've never seen them give a dime to anything. As far as I know, Texaco didn't do one thing for the community of Owasso except suck money out of it. And you just encouraged our people to vote against our customer. If everybody acted like you, Melvin and Patsy would be out of business. And her response was, I'm just a working girl trying to save a dollar. Fortunately, she was able to find other employment. If everyone made decisions with their money like I do, I'm asking you to ask this question of you. If everybody spent their dollars like I do, would my community be a better or worse place to live? I heard somebody one time suggest that a great shopping tip that we just order stuff over the internet. The example was dog food. Hey, you got a coupon here? You can order dog food over the internet. It'll be shipped to you and you can save $5. Well, how about that? What's that do for the fine family that owns Southern Ag? What's that do for our neighbors that are employed at PetSmart? Now, if you're saving the money and giving the whole $5 to Owasso First Assembly, I'm good with that. But that's normally not the way it works. Tulsa has an unbelievably vibrant Jewish community. And they are very, very good about supporting their faith. When there's a big donation made to something in Tulsa from a member of the Jewish community, I can almost guarantee you I know what bank's name is on that check. When Mormon business people travel, they all stay at one brand of hotel chains because this particular brand is owned by Mormons. It's the one that has the Bible and the Book of Mormon in the room. Islamic people tend to do business with Islamic people. So if Jewish people support Jewish people, and Mormon people support Mormon people, and Islamic people support Islamic people, who do Christians support? Whoever's the cheapest. That's my food for thought for you. How can we expand the... Think about this. Could it possibly be God's plan for your life that all of the resources he sent to you were solely for your benefit? Now, I was taught this as a secular concept as a kid. But as I read this passage, I believe it's a biblical concept. That we're to use the resources to build the kingdom. If each one of us did business with people that tithe to a local church, there would never, never, ever be another pastor asking for money. Never, ever. And Owasso would be a great place to live. And if we order it over the internet, we may save some sales tax money, but what does that do for the firefighter that lives next door? What's that do to the policeman that's ready to answer your call? What's that do to the sports park where your kids play soccer? All right. What would my community be if everybody acted like me? Okay, now let's take this to Monday. How about mortgages? The biggest investment that most of us make is going to be our home mortgage. And when you go down to fill out the mortgage application, you're going to fill out all this information, income, alimony, child support, whatever. And the mortgage banker is going to run it through a computer and going to spit out a number and tell you that you are qualified for a certain amount of mortgage. Now, here's what happens. This word qualified comes in this ear and gets kind of discombobulated with our sin nature. Assemblies of God have sin natures, right? Okay, like us Baptists? Okay. So it gets discombobulated with this sin nature and comes out the other ear as a different word. Well, the lady just told me that I was qualified for a $200,000 home loan. Do you think they get the 150 model? No. Here's the problem. I kind of talked about this a year ago with credit scores. The mortgage banking business is based on government-required models, and this information is fed into a model based on what the average consumer spends and all this data they collect from all over the world, and they come up with this number, whatever this number is. Now, here's the problem. I probably only know 12 or 15 of you, but I know every single one of you is not this person, the average consumer. That's not you. Because the average consumer spends about 1.7% of their gross income on charitable giving. So let's say for a minute that you're a tithing member of Owasso First Assembly and you tithe 10% and you give some money to the United Way or the Girl Scouts or many other charitable things that come along. And just to make my numbers work easy, let's say that you give 11.7% of your income to charity. Already, you're 10% of your gross monthly income different from the average consumer. So if the median household income in Owasso is $60,000, that's $5,000 a month. So when this stuff gets spit through this model, you're $500 short. Would $500 a month make a difference in your budget? For most of us, it would. That's the problem with this number. Whatever number they give you that you're qualified for is too much. That's why we've managed to end up with a whole society of people that have a relatively good standard of living, but none of them seem to be able to take care of God. Because society has moved us in another direction. What should the number be? 2 times your gross annual income. If your household income is $60,000, you can handle a mortgage of $120,000. And be able to live a good lifestyle, be able to tithe, and do the things you want to do. The same thing happened with car loans. When my folks moved to Owasso in 1956, guess what the average term of an automobile loan was? Are there no old people here? No. 24 months. That was the average term of an automobile loan. In the 60s, it expanded to 36 months. Now, who do you think came up with this good idea? The banks? We like to stretch things out, take longer to pay for a car. By the way, how much money do they loan you to buy a new car? How much money do you have to put down? Nothing. Exactly. You borrow 100%. Right? So the day you drive it off the lot, the bank's upside down. Right? So no bank would want to be upside down, worse, longer. No bank came up with this idea. Guess who came up with this idea? The people that sell cars. They started a financing arm called GMAC, Ford Motor Credit. So if we stretch the length out, that would reduce the, say it's a $10,000 car, we could either reduce the amount of our payment, or if we wanted to pay the same amount we would have paid up here, we could do what? Buy more car. Because if they stretch the payments out to 48, we might be able to buy a $14,000 car. What is it now? 72, 84. You know what's amazing to me? Social conservatives put their hands up against almost anything the government comes out with. Don't want to have to wear a helmet on a motorcycle. Don't make me put a seatbelt on. I mean, whatever the, you know, climate change, no. Whatever the government comes out with, we're opposed to it. Until it comes to finances. And as soon as some idiot says it's a good idea, sign me up. That's what happened. That's what's happened to us in this country. Do you know prior to World War II, 95% of working families had one income, and they all managed to pretty much get by? Now we've got 2 incomes and can't get by. A few practical thoughts. Page 3. I don't have time to go over all this, so I'll just hit some of the highlights. Be sure to have your paycheck directly deposited to your financial institution. We still have a lot of people that pay to have their check cashed. We used to finance a business over by American Airlines. It was a check cashing business, and those people just pour out of American Airlines and pay somebody $5, cash their check. Don't do that. Home mortgage refinancing, the old rule used to be that you needed to be able to save 2 percentage points on your loan to be able to afford the cost of refinancing. Now the cost of houses has gotten so much that if you can save 1 percentage point, it's worth at least looking to see if you can refinance. Vehicle purchases, this is a big one. I always encourage folks to buy used vehicles. There's so much more value there. Let that first big depreciation be paid by somebody else. And there are now plenty of places on the internet where you can find the actual cost of new cars, the dealer's cost of new cars, and what used cars are selling for, so that you can get a better value on cars. Here's my favorite one, number 9. Avoid trading houses and spouses. The average millionaire has only been married one time and has lived in his house for at least 20 years. 10, balance your checkbook. Number 10, balance your checkbook. Number 10, balance your checkbook. 30 years ago, banks ran off people that overdrew their checking account because there was only one way to overdraw your checking account. You wrote a check when you didn't have money. Now, it's easy to overdraw your checking account. There's debit cards, there's ATM machines, there's ACH transactions, there's automatic things coming out with the cable company and the data bill, and so it's very, very easy. But be very wary of paying the big fees to overdraw your account. Get a reserve line of credit tied to your checking account. I know a reasonably sized bank in our marketplace, not one of the giant ones, but a pretty big one, and they make $1 million a month on overdraft fees. Not mine. Okay, another one. Number 11, check out your insurance deductibles. I was having my car fixed one time, and a young lady I went to high school with was in there getting her car fixed, and her particular accident was her fault, so she was having to pay for it, and the bill was about $600, but she said she wasn't going to turn in the insurance claim. She only had a $250 deductible, but wasn't going to turn the claim in because she didn't want it on her record, which makes a lot of sense. And I said, well, you ought to increase your deductible to $500 or $1,000. She says, oh, well, then I couldn't afford the claim. If you're not going to turn in a $250 or $500 claim on your car, look at increasing your deductibles. You can save a lot of money on your deductibles. 401k retirement plans. If your employer is matching any portion of your contribution, take the maximum amount that they will contribute and match it. At the bank, we match 65% of what the employee puts in. And I still have a few people that are skittish and don't want to put it in. They can invest it in any multiple kinds of funds, very conservative. You can even put it in a money fund. And the reason is always, well, I'm afraid the stock market's going to go down. I don't want to lose my money. Well, how far would it have to go down for you to be a loser if we're matching 65% of what you put in? You know, that's just not going to happen. So take advantage of that. And also, what was it he said about that one timid slave? Yeah, worthless, lazy servant. Okay. Number 13, a lot of little ways to reduce expenses, and I think this is where our focus has to be. I have cable TV at the top. When we first moved out where we live, which is just north of Freedom Church, we live at 96 and 177th. We moved out there in 1994, I think. There was no cable out there. Cox wasn't out there yet. So I kind of had to wait for that subdivision across the street to develop, and Rodney Ray helped put some political pressure on Cox, I guess. And I finally got cable TV, but for 18 months, I did not have any television. The only station we could get out there was Fox. And, you know, I hated it because I like watching sports programming. But during that 18 months, I learned all of my children's names and what they like to do. You can live without cable TV. Phone lines, I actually had a couple came in for counseling one time, and I was trying to look at their expenses, and not only did they still have a landline phone, they had a second landline for their teenage kids so they could talk on the phone. Yeah, that's what I said. Whoa. Having a drink at lunch, you know, most drinks now cost $1.50 or $2 plus tax and tip. You can easily waste $20 just on pop or tea at a restaurant. I have so trained my kids, and I was so bad to my kids about never getting pop at lunch, that even my adult children now, when I take them out, I'll just have water. All this voicemail, caller ID, call blocker, eating out, it's ridiculously expensive. Lots of ways to look for money. There's one I don't have on the list here, and I don't write it down because my wife gets so mad at me and my kids get so mad at me. They say, Dad, you have to quit saying that. You know, sometimes you're actually going to be on video. Is this on? We're not videoing this put up on the internet, are we? Yeah, I was afraid you were going to say that. All right, I may have to whisper this one because I really don't want people to hear me say this. But here's one of the biggest areas you can save money that my wife and my kids do not want me to mention. Okay, are you ready? Pets. You would be amazed how much money people spend on animals. Now, I don't want you to quit just yet, because we just financed this multi-million dollar veterinary hospital down here called Small Animal Hospital of Owasso, SAHO. Dr. Spriggs, Kelly, and Strathy, they're really good friends of mine, and I'd really like them to pay that loan back. So if you need to go to that high-rise kitty condo, now, I'm not suggesting you board your cat in a high-rise kitty condo, but if you want one, this is the best one around anywhere. Seriously. Now, I'm not suggesting that you go shoot Fido. All I'm suggesting is when Fido passes, seriously consider whether you need Fido Jr. Okay. Money-saving ideas. Okay, we're almost done. Money-saving ideas. I just threw some in there. 15D, ATM fees. Just billions of dollars spent on out-of-network ATM fees. And this usually happens to kids when they go off to college because they have their local bank account here, and then when they go off somewhere, branches aren't available there. So be sure to withdraw your money and use your ATM at your own bank. I have to put this one in here. Designer clothes for babies and children. I mean, seriously, come on. My kids wore Oshkosh Bagosh overalls, and they turned out just fine. Unused gift cards. $2 billion in gift cards go unredeemed every year. And here's the amazing thing. I can't remember the number, but it starts with a B. It's in the billions of dollars that are currently on Starbucks stored value cards. Do you know that Starbucks doesn't have to borrow any money? Because all of you lend it to them for free? People will come down to the bank and complain about the littlest fee, but have no problem giving Starbucks $50 for free to use till they need it. Unused gym membership, traffic tickets. 1 in 6 people get a speeding ticket. Other ideas for money management. I like the babysitting co-op. We finally did this at our church many years ago. Shirley and I figured out just 1 year, we spent over $2,500 on childcare just for us to do ministry. That was with her teaching the youth, me off teaching, getting people to take care of our kids. $2,500. And if you could start a babysitting co-op where, you know, one night a month, I'll keep your hellions while you go out, and next week you keep mine while you go out, and not have to pay for it, that's a good idea. Last thing, you can read all this. I'll just mention this item number 17 on your credit report. There's a lot of advertisements on television that talk about getting a free credit report. You really have to watch them, because think about this. This was the first thing that caught me. Back when they had that goofy guy with the banjo and did that freecreditreport.com or whatever that was, you know, I'm thinking, now, wait a minute. I know those ads on television cost millions of dollars. They're paying millions of dollars to encourage me to sign up for their free credit report. Okay, there's got to be a catch here. Well, there is. It's not free. And they sign you up for all these other services. But these are the places where it is free. And now by law, each of these credit reporting agencies have to give you one free credit report a year. And it's good just to check it, not because of what the score is. You know, I talked about last year how these scores fluctuate. And it's not the greatest model. But it will show you if your identity's been stolen, if somebody has charged something or got a credit card in your name, kind of help you just to stay up to date. Or like if this happened to me, you know, one of my kids went to a doctor and didn't pay the copay. And unbeknownst to me, they turned it over to collection agency, and I found out I had a $25 collection action on my credit report. Well, it would have been nice to know that and get it cleaned up before you go to apply for the loan. So anyway, call me at the bank anytime if you have questions. I think this is a great series. I want to encourage all of you to be great stewards of your money. Thank you very much.